Good morning, everybody. A very, very warm welcome to London and to the Wellcome Trust. It's a great pleasure to have you here and an honor to host this, what I think is going to be a really, really crucial discussion. I think just how crucial it is a reflection just of the individuals that have given up their time to be here. So thank you very, very much. My name is Jeremy Farrar. I'm the director of the Wellcome Trust, and I will just have two jobs to do. One is to point you to this critical slide. There should be, but should is a difficult word sometimes. There should be no fire alarm. So if you hear one, it's real. And follow me, and I'll take you out of the building. The second is that you picked a perfect day to have this meeting. It's an auspicious day. It's also not only for the Academy, but it's my birthday. So a very warm welcome. A great pleasure to introduce David Relman, who's going to chair the session. David.
And that's now yours.
Oh, thank you. Yes, I'm well familiar with this bell. Well, let me first by adding my happy birthday greetings to Professor Farrar. You don't want to hear that happen. I also want to add my welcome. I am David Relman. I'm chair of the Forum on Microbial Threats at the National Academy of Medicine, formerly known as the Institute of Medicine in Washington, D.C. I'm also a professor of medicine and of microbiology and immunology at Stanford University. Just a brief word about the Forum. The Forum was created in 1996 to provide a structured opportunity for discussion and scrutiny of critical scientific and policy issues related to emerging, re-emerging, and novel infectious diseases. As a result of the Forum's efforts, priorities for infectious disease research and public health policy have been identified, and collaborations and dialogue have been promoted between the private and the public sectors, as well as between the medical, veterinary, and plant disease communities. I should note that this is the first meeting of the Forum that is being held overseas, and it's the first that is being webcast. And I thought what we might do at this point is just briefly go around the room and have members of the Forum and those guests here at the table introduce themselves. Just a brief word, starting with David.
Since you're saying the first person gets to introduce themselves, works on plant diseases. My name is Dave Rizzo. I'm the professor and chair of plant pathology at UC Davis in California.
I'm Mary Wilson. I'm a visiting professor at UCSF and adjunct professor of global health and population at the Harvard Chan School of Public Health.
I'm Kevin Anderson. I'm with the Department of Homeland Security Science and Technology Director. I do biodetection and diagnostic systems development.
Arturo Casanaval. I'm at the Johns Hopkins School of Public Health, where I'm professor and chair of microbiology.
Chris Elias. I'm the president of global development at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation.
Peter Daszak, I'm the president of EcoHealth Alliance, a New York-based nonprofit, and we work on the ecology and origins of emerging diseases.
I'm Harvey Feinberg. I'm the president of the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation.
I'm Jimena Aguilera, physician specialist in public health. I'm the director of the Center of Epidemiology and Public Policy in the Universidad del Desarrollo in Chile.
I'm WHO servant, Margaret Chen.
I'm Dr. Elaine Chaffness. I'm scholar and director of the Forum on Microbial Threats at the National Academy of Medicine within the Institute of Medicine.
I'm Peter Piotr, and I'm the director of the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine.
I'm Wally Tomori. I'm dependent on the Nigeria Academy of Science.
Jeremy Farrar.
Patrick Kelly from the Institute of Medicine.
Jesse Goodman, professor of medicine at Georgetown University.
I'm Jennifer Gardy. I have a Canada Research Chair in Public Health Genomics at the University of British Columbia, and I work at the BC Center for Disease Control.
I am Jackie Fletcher. I'm from Oklahoma State University, where I'm professor of plant pathology and also director of the National Institute for Microbial Forensics and Food and Agricultural Biosecurity.
Good morning. I'm Rima Kabaz from the CDC, where I'm Deputy Director for Infectious Diseases.
I'm Keizo Takemi, only a politician, a member of the House of Councillors.
David Heyman, Medical Epidemiologist, Chatham House in Public Health England.
Peggy Hamburg, Foreign Secretary for the National Academy of Medicine, and most importantly, former co-chair of the Forum on Microbial Threats.
I am Eduardo Gotuso, Professor of Medicine, Cayetano Heredia University, Director from the Tropical Institute in the University in Lima, Peru.
Good morning. I'm Jeff Duchin. I'm the Health Officer at Public Health, Seattle, King County, Washington, and Professor of Medicine in the Infectious Disease Division at the University of Washington in Seattle.
Good morning. I'm Mike Bell. I'm the Director of the Armed Forces Health Surveillance Center.
Thank you all for your presence and participation, and thank you all for the rest of our guests here. It's our honor at the forum to be able to help organize this workshop on global health governance on behalf of the Global Health Risk Framework Commission. The goals and objectives of this workshop will be presented by Victor Zhao in just a moment. But in short, we are here to consider the key elements of good governance for global health, to characterize the needs, gaps and barriers in our current approaches, to consider alternative models of global health governance, to examine indicators and metrics of an effective, accountable, anticipatory, and resilient system, and then to arrive at some recommendations for the Commission. The goal, of course, is that these recommendations be actionable and lead to an improved global health governance system. We also recognize the need to build on the recommendations offered just recently by several studies and reports whose representatives are here with us today. This is, of course, a tall order, but the stakes could not be more important, and of course include the health and welfare of the world's population. Let's also keep in mind that those most vulnerable to epidemic disease and most in need of support by the public health system are the 2 billion people who must live on less than $2 a day. The realities of their lives are far from those of ours here in this room and must be remembered over the next few days. Just a few more comments. This workshop represents one of the most critical data gathering activities of the Global Health Risk Framework Initiative. As a result, we're delighted to have all of you here, including Director General Chan. The meeting features attendees from Europe, Africa, Asia, and North and South America. The funding for the workshop and for the Commission's work overall reflects the generosity not only of our forum's traditional sponsors, but also the Rockefeller Foundation, represented by Robert Martin, who I think is here. Yes, thank you. The Gates Foundation, represented by Chris Elias, who is here somewhere. Yes, sorry. The Paul Allen Family Foundation, the Moore Foundation, represented by Harvey Feinberg, the Ford Foundation, represented by Darren Walker, the Wellcome Trust, as you know, Dr. Lau Ming-Wai from Hong Kong, and USAID, and Ariel Pablos-Mendez is here. Finally, in closing, I want to make clear how indebted and appreciative we are to the Wellcome Trust for hosting this event and providing critical support. Without Jeremy Farrar and his assistant Phil Green, this workshop would not have been possible. And in addition, I want to thank those from our forum, Allison Berger, Jack Herman, and Eileen Chaffness for their wonderful support. Thank you. I'd like to now introduce Victor Zhao, who I believe will appear on this screen, or his image, of his image, who will talk to us about the purpose here and the outline and goals of this initiative. And I believe that Victor needs very little introduction other than to say that he is the 10th president of the National Academy of Medicine or Institute of Medicine. Thank you.
Greetings from Washington. I'm Victor Zhao, the president of the National Academy of Medicine, formerly known as the Institute of Medicine, or IOM. I want to thank all of you being here today for this workshop on the governance for global health, which is part of the Global Health Risk Framework. I apologize for not being here in London with you today, as I have to chair a steering committee that would examine the vital directions of health and healthcare to inform the next US administration. But I do want to thank all of you for who's traveled long distances to be here and our speakers. Particularly, I'd like to thank Jeremy Farrar, who's in fact hosting this meeting for us at the Wellcome Trust, for his great support and friendship. And also, Keizo Takemi, who's our keynote speaker. I know that given his high position in Japan, that he has to get permission from the Japanese government to come here, and we have to do a lot of work to make that happen. And also my friend Margaret Chan, who has to change his schedule in order to come be a speaker this afternoon. So thank you so much. There are many other people I'd like to thank, people like Harvey Feinberg, Joanne Liu, Tomori, and David Heyman and others. Time will not permit me to thank them all individually, so I want to collectively thank all of you. So let me tell you a few words about, in fact, this particular framework, initiative, and this workshop. Now, all of us know that, in fact, over the last 1.5 years, Ebola has been devastating to people's lives, to the economy of many countries in West Africa, or 3 countries in West Africa, and of course beyond. We also know, of course, that we've learned a lot from this outbreak, and that many of us are determined that we're not going to let those lessons pass us by. And this is the reason why we're together, that is to really look at how can we collectively plan and create a comprehensive framework for the future so that we can mitigate the risk and be better prepared for and responding to infectious epidemic outbreaks or pandemics. This is the reason why we're here today. A unifying framework called Global Health Risk Framework. Now, we know that previously there's been other global pandemics such as influenza, SARS, MERS, and others. And there's been a lot of good reports done, including one by my predecessor, Harvey Feinberg. What we want to do is make sure all our reports, this report in particular, is going to be get the right attention for policymakers so that changes are going to be made in the long run and we better prepare for the future. So let me therefore go ahead and show you the background for this initiative and also the framework by which we move forward. So may I see the first slide, please? So as I said, this is to create a new global architecture for looking at the whole issue of infectious disease outbreak or medical disasters. This really started actually almost a year ago when Jim Kim and I had breakfast and we were both lamenting about what's going on and thought that maybe IOM or NAM should do some work in this area. We were quickly joined by Judith Roden, the president of Rockefeller Foundation, who provides us with support. And of course, we have Margaret Chan from WHO to give us strong advice. So together, we started planning towards this framework. We have held 2 meetings, one in December 2014, where Margaret chaired the meeting, and we got the experts together to look at how to get to zero case. But the second meeting in March is when we, in fact, started planning for this framework, and subsequently we've launched the Global Health Risk Framework. We've been very fortunate to have support from many foundations and funders. As you can see in the slide in the bottom, we've had support from Paul Allen Foundation, Ford Foundation, Gates Foundation, Ming Wai Lau from Hong Kong, Moore Foundation, Rockefeller Foundation, USAID, and of course, Wellcome Trust. This next slide shows you the architecture of the Global Health Risk Framework Initiative. Importantly is the appointment of a commission which is independent and global, has 18 commissioners made of experts in diverse areas such as law, health, financing, private sector, public sector, civil society, etc. This group of commissioners come from multiple countries, so it's a truly international commission. This group will lead the effort to create a comprehensive report that really addresses the key issues that we're facing in the infectious outbreaks and pandemics. They include the issues about governance for global health, which you're here for today, but also how to finance these emergencies and responses. The importance of strengthening health systems from public health to healthcare delivery, and of course, last but not least, to get the research and development of medical products, particularly finding participation from the private sector, providing incentives and others, so that in fact we have vaccines and products all ready for, or rapidly ready for the future. So the next slide shows you, in fact, the membership of the commission is chaired by Peter Sands and Owali Tomori. As you can see, this is a group of highly distinguished individuals. I'm sure you recognize many of the names, but also they are truly multinational. And this group will actually work very hard to create this final report. Now, this whole initiative is overseen by an international oversight group, which is chaired by myself and vice chaired by Judith Roden from Rockefeller Foundation. But we have, in fact, the participation of Jeremy Farrar, Omi-san from Japan, Paul Pullman, Myrta Roses, and many others that we recognize. This group's role is to help overseeing the process, appointing the commissioners, but also in overseeing the review process and help disseminate the report when it's done. So you're here today for the governance workshop. And of course, important in the governance workshop is the many issues we need to discuss about the responsibilities, constraints of countries, of regional institutions, the WHO and other relevant UN agencies, and of course the international health regulations. And really examine from the see lessons learned, examine the responses, and assess options for change to international governance framework. And you can see the bullets on this slide, which I won't go over with you today. You have plenty of time to discuss this. So this slide shows you a timeline on the entire global health risk framework. We have a very aggressive timeline because we want the report to be done by the end of November, early December, in time for, in fact, the UN high-level panel report. We are in close coordination with them. And also positioning for the World Health Assembly and other major events. So you can see we have started a commission meeting in July. Between August and September, we have four workshops. In fact, three of them already held prior to coming here to London today. The first one is Resilient Health System in Ghana. It was apparently extremely energetic and lots of great ideas. I participated in an R&D workshop in Hong Kong. I can tell you that, in fact, the discussion was frank, honest, and extremely effective with lots of good ideas going forward. I also participated in a pandemic financing workshop in Washington, of course, bringing together people with expertise, including reinsurance, many others are so important. And of course, you're here for the governance workshop, which is a key aspect of the future. The commissions are going to meet twice more, and they will meet in September, November to release a report. And of course, what we want to do is make sure this report gets the viewpoint, at least into the sight of major policymakers. So working with many people, including Takemi-san in Japan for the G7 coming up in Japan, but also other major events, we're trying to position, in fact, this report to be well disseminated. So this is what this whole initiative is about. I just want to tell you that we have a very important job because really, in many ways, we want to make sure this doesn't happen again. You know, this is the opportunity for us to make a difference, and I look forward to working closely with you. And on behalf of National Academy of Medicine, thank you, and have a great workshop today. Thank you.
So we are going to now move on to our keynote address. And for that, it is my great honor and pleasure to be able to introduce our keynote speaker, Keizo Takemi. The Honorable Professor Takemi has had a remarkable career. He received his undergraduate and graduate degrees from the Faculty of Law at Keio University. He followed a career path in the academy, and in 1995 was appointed a professor in the School of Political Science and Economics at Tokai University. But then his career took on a public dimension when, while serving as an anchor on CNN in Japan, he was noticed by the Liberal Democratic Party and encouraged to run for political office. Soon thereafter, Professor Takemi was elected a member of the Japanese House of Counselors in their national parliament, where he served for 12 years. He also served as State Secretary for Foreign Affairs in the Obuchi cabinet in 1999 and as Senior Vice Minister of Health, Labor, and Welfare in the first Abe cabinet. One of his major achievements in office was a complete overhaul of Japan's system of allocating overseas development aid. And in doing so, he was able to ensure that aid policy was not only coherent and consistent, but also that it was based on the concept of human security as a core principle. Since leaving political office in 2007, Professor Takemi has served the role of global health diplomat. He has led a number of UN-sponsored efforts in global health reform, helped formulate Japan's role in promoting a global health agenda, and has helped to lead the WHO's Global Health Workforce Alliance. It's my pleasure to introduce Professor Takemi.
David, thank you very much for your very kind introduction for me. And it's really a great pleasure having this wonderful occasion to talk about this very important subject, how to cope with the emerging risky infectious diseases in this very crowded global community. And especially I currently serve as chair of the LDP Special Mission Committee on Global Health Strategy. Today, I will present my personal views in that capacity. The national diet is, maybe as you know, that the currently discussing legislation for peace and security that, if endorsed, will redefine the security risks the nation needs to address. I believe that the Japan's future-oriented proactive pacifism reflects the key elements of national security as well as the human security. The human security will be ensured through our collective action to solve the common challenges that threaten our lives, livelihoods, and dignity. Health is one of the core values within the concept of the human security. Among the diet members, the recognition is emerging that an infectious diseases outbreak in one country is increasingly likely to become a threat to another country. However, this sense of urgency and health interdependence needs to be promoted further. The more we regard infectious diseases as threat to our own national security, the better we understand the importance of taking collective action toward controlling the spread of infections at the earliest possible stage. I believe that this emerging perception is essential to engage the policymakers in restructuring governance for global health and expanding the scope of security discourse to include the both the health security and human security. I'd like to remind you that the political parties and the politicians in every country have a critical role to play in advocacy around this idea. Last week, I proposed that the government of Japan take a more proactive response to infectious diseases and enhance our global health policy in order to foster the greater understanding and consent within the government. The next year, Victor Zou just mentions that Japan will host the G7 summit, and I'm pleased to inform you that the last Monday, Japan's Prime Minister Shinzo Abe stated in response to my questions at the Budget Committee that the government of Japan intends to proactively contribute to international discussions about the governance for global health as a host, the country of the G7 summit next year. Now, why have we not discussed the governance and leadership issues at the global level in the past? The last G8, the summit hosted by the Japanese government, happened in 2008. In the preparation in the summer of the previous year, in 2007, our government identified the global health as a viable summit agenda item based on the policy recommendations made by the public and the private policy platform. And it was a really quite unfortunate thing that in 2007, unfortunately, I lost my job at the upper house election. I became really free. And then Prime Minister Fukuda asked me to be the head of this task force for the agenda setting and the policy proposal to G8 summit at that time. And then, since global health resonated well with the concept of human security, which the government of Japan has been promoting as a pillar of its foreign policy since 1998. Our recommendations were accepted by the government, and they established for the first time a G8 health expert group to lay the groundwork for the G8 summit agenda. In 2007, the two major reports on the health systems were published. The World Bank's report on a healthy development and the WHO's Everybody Business, and Joy Pumafi, she was in charge for this report of healthy development as a vice president then. And then the following the trend set by these reports and through the consultations with the public-private policy platform and fellows in the global health community, the government of Japan proposed the health system strengthening as one of the major agenda item at the G8 Toyoko Summit. At the summit, the G8 leaders ultimately committed to promoting both disease-specific and health systems approach in the summit declaration. However, at the time, I humbly recall that no one proposed that the governance and leadership should be made a priority for the G8 summit in 2008, despite it being one of the six building blocks of the health system defined by the WHO Everybody Business Report. I would like to propose a question for discussion at this conference. Why did we not thoroughly examine and discuss governance and leadership in 2008. But before the getting into a discussion of governance for global health, it is important to first define it. My friend Claire Frank refers to governance for global health as the way in which the global health systems are managed. The global health system is defined as the organized the social response to health conditions at the global level. The global governance has fundamental dilemmas. To begin with, there is no government at the global level. To make matters more complex, health is increasingly influenced by decisions that are made in other global policy-making areas, and the world is becoming increasingly pluralistic with the emergence of the many non-state actors. Thus, the sovereignty challenge, the sectoral challenge, and the accountability challenge are embedded into the structure of the global health. And based on this understanding, I think that there have been four main reasons for our avoidance of discussing the governance and leadership issues. First, politicians, the national tendency is avoid the political risks of being perceived as interfering with the sovereignty of nation state. The second is the role of bureaucratic tensions among international agencies, which have deep organizational interests that hinder a collective action. The third, the many global health policymakers were not equipped to bring together multiple sectors and break down each sector's siloed decision making. The fourth, the proliferation of non-state actors has made it increasingly difficult and time consuming to solve the problems. I believe that the Ebola outbreak strikingly revealed the weakness of the existing global health architecture and will lead the world to focus more on the governance and global health. Now, so why did we start discussing governance for global health? How did we recognize its importance and urgency? Although the Ebola outbreak is a game changer, our attention to the changing global health environment is not new. Over the past 30 years, we have seen unprecedented emergence of threats from infectious diseases all over the world. The end of the last century, HIV/AIDS, the SARS outbreak in 2003, H1N1 outbreak in 2009, drew more attention not only to the goal, the risks of the zoonotic infections, but also to environmental health and man-made threats, including multi-drug resistance bacteria in the context of increased international transfers of health risks. The global health field has become more diversified, with WHO playing less of the dominant role. Sorry to Margaret. But the UNAIDS was created in 1996 with the important responsibility of responding to then the rapidly increasing epidemic of HIV/AIDS. Peter Piot was appointed as first executive director. Other agencies like UNICEF and the UNFPA have refined their strategies in child, maternal, and reproductive health toward the achievement of the Millennium Development Goals. Thus, even within the UN systems, the global health players have been increasing in numbers and expanding in scope without a formal coordinating structure. In addition, many non-state actors have developed their own strengths and are increasing their presence on the ground. There are growing challenges to hold these various non-state actors accountable. On the other hand, various types of multi-stakeholders organizations such as the Global Fund and the Gavi Alliance were established. The Global Fund was launched with the engagement of non-state actors in its governance in order to enhance the legitimacy and ownership of each actor. More recently, another partnership was established in Japan called the Global Health Innovative Technology Fund. We called it the GHIT. I have been keeping my eyes on its development. GHIT comprises a consortium of private companies as its members and representatives from the Japanese government, not only from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, but also from the Ministry of Health. And the representative and the pharmaceutical industry and the Gates Foundation as its partners. And I welcome and appreciate the Wellcome Trust for the great contribution to GHIT's the growth. I believe that the forward-looking and innovative business model such as this is in the high demand. It is necessary to create a global network of similar public and private partnership schemes in which the pharmaceutical companies are enabled to strategize their investments in research and development to respond to the needs of the people living at the frontiers of the health threats in the developing countries. We all need to support this movement, and I would like to propose that my government include this topic in the agenda of the next G7 summit. So what makes the Ebola outbreak such a wake-up call for us in the global health community? The Ebola outbreak hit an area where people are particularly vulnerable and have suffered poverty for a long time, and their health system were especially weak. Under these circumstances, neither the nation states nor the intergovernmental organizations were able to effectively prevent, contain, or control the spread of Ebola. Instead, the risk of infections gradually expanded to other countries, leading the world to question the effectiveness and legitimacy of the existing global health framework. These weaknesses warn us of the necessity to create the linkages at the all levels of the governance, starting at the community level to local, national, and global levels of the governance. The Ebola outbreak in particular reminds us of the necessity to support the governance system at the community level, especially in places where national or local governments remain especially vulnerable. People still rely on and are influenced by the decisions of the traditional leaders, and their national and local governments are trying to utilize the existing community structures in their decentralization process. In the remainder of my remarks, I'd like to propose the several key issues that we need to discuss at this important meeting. They are based on the five challenges that we observed as our primary weakness in the Ebola response. The first, the affected countries' health systems were not resilient and were particularly poorly prepared to respond to large-scale epidemics. The second, the WHO was not well prepared to provide the quality and quantity of support that the countries needed. The third, responses to health crises are poorly funded, and the distribution of funds to and within affected countries is all too often delayed. Fourth, international health regulations were not functioning sufficiently and not embracing the voice of civil society well enough, while identifying necessary action to be taken by WHO and member states and other important stakeholders for the INH. Fourth, the UN agencies, bilateral donors, military groups, and NGOs were not coordinated efficiently. Let's look at these challenges one by one. The first, how to enhance the resilient and sustainable health system through the collective action at multiple levels of governance. The Ebola outbreak has shown that the affected countries did not possess the resilient health system that could promptly detect, control, and contain the spread of disease. The people in these countries have lived in the poverty with poor nutrition and with the poor sanitation for decades. Many of them do not have access to health information or services. In fact, we witnessed the acceleration of the spread of the disease through the indigenous habits, beliefs, and rituals of blaming the dead. Furthermore, after the long-lasting conflicts of the 1990s, it is not surprising that people and the community have been disappointed and remain suspect of the ability and effectiveness of the national and local governments to provide them with the basic social services. When we think of resilient and sustainable health systems, we need to pay attention to multidimensional factors beyond health that undermine resilience and sustainability. Our experience in Japan shows that it is necessary and effective to develop and implement a comprehensive policy package in the field of social welfare, labor, economy, trade, and industry to tackle various socio-economic challenges and maximize opportunities for growth. Our industry in the 1950s, 60s, successfully developed a variety of effective drugs with support from the government to prevent diseases like tuberculosis and high blood pressure. and it expanded the community-based health care to enhance the people-centered preventive care at the community level. The recognition of the importance of the community-centered approaches was fostered at all the national, local, and the community levels to ensure the provision of the multi-sectoral social services. In my view, the world after the Ebola outbreak requires increased attention to this community-centered approach. It is essential to enhance the people's knowledge and the capacity toward building resilient health system. The world's population, including those in infectious disease-prone areas, has increasingly demanded prevention, diagnosis, treatment, and care vis-a-vis their more diverse needs. These health services also require sustainable and equitable the health financing so they can be provided at the affordable cost. More importantly, we policymakers have the responsibility to support the context-specific formulation of these comprehensive policies, considering interlinkages among interventions at all levels of the governance from the community to the global. And then, throughout these processes, we always need to remind ourselves that the community is our target level, where universal access to social services should be achieved in all circumstances. It is critical for all of us to share this common political objective when discussing collective action by intergovernmental organizations. In sum, the Ebola outbreak has provided, in my view, a litmus test of our international solidarity and of our endeavor to promote the human security. So, what kind of governance system for the global health will work for effectively to solicit the collective action and maximize importance on the societies? Let me address the four other challenges I just mentioned for our discussions at this meeting. The following, the resilience of the health systems. The second challenge is the capacity and the role of WHO. I believe that it is still non-states and the intergovernmental systems that should continue to play the leading role. The mission of the intergovernmental organization is to protect the people beyond the national borders from the infectious diseases and other common threats, as well as to empower the populations to take action based on informed decisions. In the field of global health, I believe that the WHO should retain its central role in international health crisis management. The WHO has received the severe criticism for the delay in its declaration of the public health emergency of international concerns and for its ineffective response to the Ebola outbreak. I quite often frequently watched the TV and watched the lovely two shots of the Margaret and the Keiji Fukuda. But that's really unfair only to blame those the people of the WHO. There are so many other various reasons that happen in this sort of things. We have to carefully check those the reasons in this meeting, I think. The rather we should take this opportunity to increase the political momentum around the global governance and leadership issues. This is unfortunate things, the outbreak of the Ebola crisis. But this is the wonderful occasion politically for us because we can utilize this increasing political momentum as a political leverage to put those the expert influences into the real decision making. Maybe the G7 hosted by the Japanese government will be that sort of place then next year. The WHO, including AFRO, is discussing how to strengthen its capacity to respond to future crises like the devastating Ebola outbreak. The plans include the establishment of the Center for Emergency Preparedness and Response and also of a contingency fund, which attempt to bring the different sectoral the cultures between health security and the humanitarian assistance together and merge them into one within the WHO. I hope this has happened. The prompt decision-making and rapid responses in the early stages are key to containing the spread of diseases.
but the subject is remaining. How the existing framework, such as OCHA of the UN quota, can be related to each other with those of the WHO's new scheme. This is not the easy framework in which the both sides can coexist to play in the most efficient way. We have to carefully design those two different cultures, very much indeed. The third challenge that I mentioned is the securing and sustaining financial resources for emergency responses. The World Bank Group has proposed the new pandemic emergency facility currently being discussed with the WHO and the private sector. Within the framework of the facility, the leading option would be an insurance mechanism. In the form of the insurance contract signed between the facility and the insurance companies in exchange for a premium. When the trigger is activated, though it requires concerted efforts, the insurance companies would make the payoffs to the facility, which in turn would then pass on these resources to the various agencies involved in a containment effort. The subjects are remaining. How to create the scheme of the trigger decision making? This is a very serious subject, I think. And secondly, the remaining subject, that how the PEF can finance on the preparedness for the potentially the recipient countries. This is also another very serious subject, how to finance on it. The fourth challenge is that the international health regulation have provoked the necessary but not sufficient to contain infectious diseases. Considering the spillover effects of the outbreaks of infectious diseases in multiple sectors, we need to engage those other sectors such as food, animals, the trade, and commerce. For example, we need to engage the WTO to help mitigate the negative incentives for disclosure of a disease outbreak. However, no intergovernmental organization can enforce the IHL against the sovereignty. It is worrisome that according to the article of the Harvey Feinberg, the only 66% of the WHO member states currently comply with the IHL. In order to encourage them to enhance their capacity to implement and comply with the IHL, there are at least three key elements. First, it is important to generate the incentives for nation states through concerted multiple financing mechanism in the new emergency response framework. Second, the strong leadership with the multi-sectoral influence is needed to solicit the collective action. I trust that the leadership of the heads of the state is the most effective to overcome cultural differences between sectors and levels of the governance. The third, international solidarity is urgently required to foster common political approaches in this era of the increasing the health interdependence. In Japan, upon the receiving the LDP's proposal, chaired by myself, the government is considering the establishment of the ministerial level meetings involving all relevant ministries and under the leaderships of the Prime Minister to prepare for and respond to the threat of the infectious diseases more effectively. Only the heads of state of each country can initiate and manage such a multi-sectoral group. The last but not least is the question of coordination among organizations. It is obvious that we do not need to create a new agency for this particular purpose. It is also obvious that the WHO needs to work more closely with other UN agencies like UNDP, UNICEF, FAO, WFP, and the World Bank Group. These partners can also influence policymaking at both the global and the country levels. There must also be effective mechanism to work with those groups that deliver the services on the ground in the disasters, especially NGOs and the military unit. This is especially true in preparing for and responding to the pandemics, mobilizing and allocating resources, and regulating the implementation of the IHL at the global level. This coordination must address the dysfunctional bureaucratic politics that exist among international agencies. With improved collective action among intergovernmental organizations, we can progressively develop a tangible coordination mechanism, to mutually complement bilateral cooperation and enhance collaboration with non-state actors. I have a keen interest in listening to your discussion later today and tomorrow on the effectiveness of AMIA in the control of the Ebola pandemic in the West Africa. Now, in conclusion, with respect to the five challenges that I have just outlined, we need to collect the policy advice and political wisdom from everybody to support decisions by the global leadership in making use of its cross-sectoral influence to carry out effective governance strengthening at all levels and effective linkages across levels. Overcoming different cultures within and among organizations is challenging, but we need to build the common policy concept to promote the collective action taken under the strong political leadership at the global and national levels, as well as we are sharing the common policy concept from the bottom, the community levels, to the top, the global levels. We can design the more efficient and consistent decision-making at the all levels to collaborate each other. Now, building community-centered health system is a cost-effective way to sustain these efforts and require collective action from all actors, political leaders, the researchers, the private sector, and civil society, as well as local communities. Policy makers need to take this opportunity to establish a common understanding of the importance of comprehensive policy packages and ensure the prompt and consistent implementation at all levels to strengthen the governance for global health. I strongly believe that the human security is a highly potential policy concept that can be shared among us to galvanize the effective collaboration at every level of society. Proposals for strengthening global governance for health need to be aligned and supported by both effective leadership and political action. The governance is not just architecture. As David Fielder has reminded us, the good governance requires good architects and creative builders. The people with strong skills in reconstruction after disasters. In short, the good governance requires political skills. A key message for this meeting is the following. The governance is profoundly dependent on the leadership and the politics. The next year, Japan is honored to host the G7 summit. I'm confident that the summit will be able to transcend ministerial boundaries as each G7 member state is represented by its head of state. In Japan, we have formed a working group of experts consisting of the emerging leaders in academia, the private sector, and the government to discuss various issues of global health, including governance for global health. I expect this interdisciplinary group to produce the dynamic policy recommendations for the world leaders the next year. Furthermore, in the lead-up to the 2016 G7 summit, Japan will host an international conference on universal health coverage in new development era, as well as the fifth, the Global Fund Replenishment Preparatory Meeting at the end of this year, December. Invitations to the above conference are signed by the heads of the five co-organizers, three ministries, the Finance and Foreign Affairs and Health, and JICA, and the Japan Center for International Exchange. This is the leading the NGO. This is a remarkable symbol of a new development era in which the multi-sectoral cooperation has become a mainstreamed. Let us make full use of each of these opportunities to discuss the governance for global health as a top priority and take collective action toward the common goals. I sincerely look forward to hearing your views based on your own well-versed, diverse experiences at this meeting. Your views will be critical for Japan to feed into policy proposals for the 2016 G7 summit and its preparatory meetings in the coming months in December. Thank you very much for your attention.
Professor Takemi, is this on? I don't think it is. A belated thank you for your thoughtful, wise, and insightful comments. We also appreciate your leadership in this area. Thank you. We will have time to return to a number of the themes that Professor Takemi raised with time for discussion in our subsequent sessions. But because of time, I think we will move on to our first session. This session will address definitions of governance for global health, as well as lessons learned from outbreaks of the past. And I'm delighted that our session moderator is Jimena Aguilera, who is director of the Center for Epidemiology and Public Health Policies at Universidad del Desarrollo in Chile. Sorry about the butchering of your university's name. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Is this working, the microphone?
Yes.
Because of the time, we're going to move rapidly to the session. This first session has two parts. The first part, we're going to discuss the elements of good governance for global health. And for that part, we have two speakers, David Fidler, that is already there, that is one of the world leading experts in international law and global health. And he's going to talk about what is global health governance in the context of recognizing and mitigating the threat of epidemic and infectious diseases. After David's presentation, Alejandro Tirman from the OIE is going to talk us about global health security that begins by assessing and assisting national capacity at the animal-human interface. Each of them going to have 20 minutes, and then we are going to open the floor for 20 minutes for discussion. Then we're going to move to the coffee break, and then the second part of this session about the lesson learned of previous emergencies. The goals of this session is to illuminate key elements of good governance, as the discussion that we, in the bright speaking that we had recently, and examine the compliance enhancing mechanism to drive good governance and implementation of existing international norms. Then the second part is going to be more oriented to synthesize the lesson learned and identify ways in which international health regulation can be modified to achieve its intended purpose. So we're going to begin the first part. So David, you have the floor.
Thank you. Just let me thank the organizers, the commission, and the workforce stream on global health governance for inviting me to participate in this important meeting. Let me just give you a quick overview of what I'm going to try to do quickly in 20 minutes. I'm going to try to give you a conceptual, analytical overview of what we mean when we talk about good governance and connect that with this concept of global health governance as well. And specifically, our focus is in looking at the threat of infectious diseases. It's going to be at a 30,000-foot level. I'm not going to dig into any of the specific topics that you have speakers and discussion and debate later in the session. I'm going to do this in three parts. Perhaps it's appropriate that they ask a lawyer to start off with giving some definitions. All right, so I'll give you some definitions of governance, global governance, and good governance. You might not think much of the definitions, but at least I'm going to try. Second, I want to spend some time trying to understand how global health governance on infectious diseases has evolved over time, with that idea of what is good governance in mind. Third, I want to consider some issues that are raised by defining these key terms and understanding the trajectory over time of global governance on infectious diseases in light of what we've seen happen in the Ebola outbreak. Because we really need to try to identify as starkly as possible what's at stake here in a governance sense. I'm going to try to do that. All right. Some definitions. I just want to preface some of this by mentioning that, at least it's my experience working in this field for many, many years, that we tend to dance around some of the key things that are going on when we talk about governance or global health governance. I'm going to try to not do that. I'm guilty of that as well. And I really want to start by talking about governance. We often don't necessarily focus on this, or we focus sometimes on the wrong thing. But when we're talking about governance, we're talking basically, in essence, about the exercise of political power. That makes some people uncomfortable, but that's really what's going on, and we need to keep that in mind. So when we talk about global governance, we're talking about the exercise of political power through the interaction of state and non-state actors in relationship to cross-border threats or cross-border opportunities. Right, continuing that, when we talk about global health governance, then that's global governance to manage cross-border threats and opportunities that are related to human health. And you're going to get discussion in the next speaker on animal health issues, but my focus is on the human health. All right. This is where I come to these, what I call these definitional deficits. Many definitions of global health governance tend to neglect, obscure, don't talk about, don't mention this exercise of political power. What we tend to do with these definitions is describe actors, describe processes, describe normative principles, describe objectives, but we don't have definitions that really zero in on that. And if you want to see an example of what I'm talking about, page 2 of the workshop agenda gives you one of those definitions, right? I'm guilty of this too. I've defined it in the same sort of way, but today I'm going to try to move in a different direction. All right. This session specifically has a focus about what good governance is. And as everybody who's participated in these debates know, we tend to get a very long list of things that we consider elements of good governance, right? Legitimacy, transparency, accountability, equity, it's based in human rights, it's effective, on and on and on. I just don't have time to try to run through all of these things. So what I've tried to do is, from that longer list, identify some categories, at least for analytical purposes, in moving this forward. And these categories are really where these elements slot in for purposes of what is good governance, or what we think should be good governance when we're talking about the exercise of political power. And that's participation, in other words, who's involved, functions, what are we doing in connection with governance, organizational, how are we going about doing governance, where are we doing the governance, principles, why are we doing it, sort of the normative energy behind these, and outcomes, whether we're actually hitting the objectives that we've set through our governance mechanisms. All right, unfortunately, you can't probably see it, but there's supposed to be a little triangle there that's slotting out to show expansion over time. I'm not sure why that's not. Can you see that? Okay, all right, never mind. I can't see it from here. All right. What we can see in terms of the idea of good governance over time is that we've really had an expansion of expectations about what is good governance. So when we start back in the mid-1800s with the beginning of international health cooperation and diplomacy to where we are today, we've really just had this dramatic expansion in terms of what we mean by good governance. Right? And we can then slot that in terms also of a parallel expansion with regards to global governance for infectious diseases. Right? And here what I'm trying to communicate is really the development of a very complex, what social scientists or political science talk about, a very complicated regime complex. We start with really one regime. We really literally started with that back with the international sanitary conferences and international sanitary conventions in the mid-1800s. As we move in terms of the development of governance mechanisms, we begin to develop a regime complex. In other words, a number of different governance mechanisms that are sort of operating in the space of human health. That in that middle part of the graph here was largely based in intergovernmental institutions, WHO, GATT, UNICEF, UNEP, things of that nature. We continue to go farther. This is where we really get the proliferation in terms of global governance for infectious diseases, where we have so many institutions, so many actors, so many processes, so many objectives involved in this sort of proliferation, where we produce this really, maybe we should call it a regime omniplex. We really have so much going on in connection with global governance for infectious diseases. And a lot of that proliferation is really connected to these sort of proliferation moments, if you will. We've sort of heard mention of these already. So we can see that in connection with governance responses to AIDS, formation of UNAIDS, the crisis in emerging and re-emerging infectious diseases. We could see that leading to the Global Fund. The SARS outbreak led to the radically new international health regulations. We're, of course, debating about what's going to happen. Is Ebola one of these proliferation moments, or are we going to see governance go in a different direction with regards to this outbreak? All right. Let me talk a little bit about now connecting that global health governance proliferation with the exercise of political power, because that proliferation has produced some really big political problems. First, we know that that proliferation really intensifies competition for scarce resources. And we've seen, for example, lots of complaints in global health about why HIV/AIDS gets so much money and other issues don't, right? That's an example of competition. There's tensions over agenda setting. Who's really getting to set the agenda here and why, given all the actors, all the processes, all the mechanisms that we have in place? There are the concerns about WHO's role as the what was thought to be the central international authority for governance. As Professor Takimi talked about, we have demands for collective action about collective action. That's the coordination problem. That's a whole political problem that comes up from this proliferation. As we begin to sort through all of these various things, we begin to get a sense of what is really driving global health governance, right? And this is the exposure of the real sources of political power in this proliferation. And that makes people very uncomfortable. And that proliferation and these political problems that are coming out of it produced calls for various reforms. This is before Ebola. Many of you are, you know, familiar with the old debate about reforming the institutional architecture for global health governance. Right? That didn't go anywhere. Right? Or what we need to do is develop, implement a new operational principle, a strategy to organize this pluralistic global health governance regime. And that's what we saw happen, and that was the strategy of global health security. Right? So what we tried to do with this idea of global health security is tie this pluralistic governance context together with an operating principle. And through global health security, we were trying to rethink what we meant by health. We're rethinking the idea of security, national and international security. We're trying to use that rethinking of those concepts to inform governance on health. And not surprisingly, this did cause some controversy because it was a move away from some other types of operational principles or strategies that people in global health thought equally important. But the idea here is that we were attempting through this strategy to organize politically this pluralistic governance environment in order so that we could get closer to what we were talking about with regards to good governance, the participation, the organization, the principle, all of these issues. And I'm not going to talk in detail about the IHR, but I think the IHR really became sort of the symbol, the embodiment of this strategy of global health security more than anything else that I could identify in global governance on infectious diseases. So if we wanted to plot our good governance categories against the IHR, we can kind of see what's going on here. There's a strategic effort to hit these targets, right? So in participation, we open the new IHR up to the formal participation, active participation of non-state actors, including as well as states. Functional, we're focusing here on prevention, protection, and response, not just to a handful of diseases that we once were worried about in the 19th century, but to lots of known and unknown public health risks. Organizationally, the IHR empowered the WHO and WHO leadership to do some radically new things. Principles, we're integrating a number of different important normative objectives: national security, protecting economic interests, respecting human rights, and effectiveness, right? At least up until and through H1N1, I think the conclusion was it's not perfect, but this is working a lot better than the previous very ineffective and totally irrelevant international health regulations that we had before, all right? Okay, and then comes Ebola. I don't have to tell this audience, this was a disaster for good governance. And it's also a disaster for the proliferation, the pluralism of global health governance, And it was a disaster for the global health security strategy. All right, so let's try to walk through this, at least here focusing on good governance as our first topic. And again, this is a perspective that not necessarily everybody will agree with, but again, connecting this idea of governance back to the exercise of political power, let me try to walk through these categories quickly. In terms of participation, I think when you look at this, what we've seen is this idea of inclusive participation that we were thinking about in terms of global health governance really gave way to the dominance of the major powers in responding to this outbreak. Functionally, we had to address a humanitarian disaster, not just try to control an outbreak, right? That's a different function. Things got out of control. Organizationally, our empowered WHO failed here. UN efforts were widely criticized in terms of responding to the outbreak. In terms of principles, national security, economic interest, human rights were all damaged or threatened seriously. Effectiveness, all right, when the outbreak started to be brought under control, it was done in ways that do not resemble the institution strategies and rules that were designed to deal with these types of outbreaks, right? We basically had to deal with this with a combination of expeditionary military campaign, with ad hoc organizations being set up. This wasn't the plan, right, in terms of the exercise of political power. This is really devastating, right? After all of the proliferation, all of the effort, all of the attention, all of the resources, all of the actors involved, all of the functions, all of the institutions, right? We end up at this moment. Why, right? Why did this happen after all of that effort? Well, here, I guess my hypothesis is that what we're seeing are massive gaps between this proliferation of global governance on infectious diseases and how political interests and political power are actually formed and actually exercised in these contexts. This is the gap between what we think we have as governance and the actual essence of governance, which is the exercise of political power. So if we wanted to think about that proliferation in terms of political interests and power, we don't actually have as much change as we thought on the political side over time. It's actually a fairly narrow range of interests and power that are driving this. This is actually difficult to swallow, but if governance is the exercise of political power, I think we really have to be more serious about looking at these gaps, right? So when we talk about governance, we really need to be asking the question as it relates to the exercise of political power. All right, just a couple of more thoughts as we look at going forward here. There are governance choices that this commission and other panels and efforts are looking at. This is rather binary. I know it's not sophisticated in that sense, but one of those choices is, are we going to continue to proliferate? Are we going to continue to expand what we do? Or is this a moment actually to go in a different direction, to consolidate governance, to bring it back more to where we see the real realistic potential for the exercise of political power and authority? Right, so we could expand things. We could give WHO even more things to do, more capacity to handle functions that it hasn't really had before. Or some people have been talking about, well, actually, we need to limit what WHO does, focus it on some core functions. Right? Are we going to amend the IHR? Are we going to try to add even more things to the IHR than it currently has when we can't even get compliance with what we already have? Or are we going to focus on just a subset of the obligations that currently exist, perhaps core capacities for surveillance and response? Right? These are choices that they're sort of high level presented in a binary way, but I think it's important to think about, because the trajectory of expanding this even more and more and more, right, we have evidence on the table that this isn't really working, and it's certain this is where it all fell apart with regards to Ebola. All right, last slide. All right. Now, given that the essence of governance is this exercise of political power, I think this commission and this workforce stream really needs to critically scrutinize political realities. There are no end of ideas and no end of proposals, but we really should encourage the taking of this step, right? Different people have different perspectives about where we are today. Based on my involvement with this and talking with lots of different people in lots of different contexts, I'm not so sanguine about what I'm seeing in terms of the political realities here. And just give me one perspective, for example, on the World Health Assembly meeting in May 2005. Here I want to refer to what WHO member states did. I know there's lots of pointing to the World Health Assembly meeting as being a positive outcome, but another perspective is this looks like business as usual, right? So WHO member states didn't increase the CESS contributions, but they expanded what they expected WHO to do. They didn't seek accountability for WHO leadership or staff in the wake of Ebola. They didn't agree to new innovative ways to interact with civil society. They agreed to a new initiative that's funded by voluntary contributions, the contingency fund, which was people have been thinking that's been one of the fundamental problems with the way WHO operates. And what happened at the World Health Assembly was overshadowed by developments outside of WHO, the G7 with the Global Health Security Agenda, World Bank proposals, et cetera, et cetera. Right? And if we just, again, if we continue along this line of more and more proliferation, without much of that proliferation or these ideas or proposals bearing any serious connection to how political interests are formed or political power is exercised, I don't think we're going to be making progress here in terms of good governance for global health governance.
Well, let's move to the next speaker, Alejandro Thielman. He is president of the Terrestrial Animal Health Commission of the World Organization for Animal Health.
Good morning. Thank you to the organizers, and thank you, Dr. Aguilera, for the introduction. It's a great honor, it's a great pleasure to join you and to introduce our organization that has not appeared in the slides yet. And I will tell you a little bit about our experience in dealing with governance. I think we have to define, and although I'm certainly not a lawyer, all who feel that we have to define governance in global health governance, and I suggest that we take a look and modify the paradigm. To me, global health governance is much more than human health. It's what Dr. Brian Evans discussed as health. Humans, ecosystem, animals, living together harmoniously. We need to talk about health, not about diseases. And for this health, we need to talk at the entire so-called One Health that I think I've attended about 10 or 12 conferences that I think we have reached the day to start practicing it. We should, at least from our perspective, we should focus much more on securing prevention at national levels and assessing and assisting countries in implementing these standards. We do have also an IHR, which in the OIE they're called the OIE Code, which are rights and obligations for members. And we find that not only do they have that obligation, but we have the obligation to be able to assist in the implementation of these obligations on countries that cannot. And we need to reward transparent reporting. And in our case, it's more serious than in human health, that transparent reporting has a very immediate impact. Negative impact on trade. And of course, we need to improve coordination intergovernmental organizations, but also encourage more coordination at national levels. We took a look at the situation during the H5N1 pandemic threat. Unfortunately, at that time, we had our tool that we'll describe shortly, the PBS, in its embryonic form. I brought the PBS as an invention from a colleague of mine working for ICA in Central America that developed an evaluation tool to judge the quality of private-public partnership in order to ascertain the sustainability of projects in these countries during the times of political changes. These governments usually didn't last more than 3 or 4 years, and it was the private sector and during this partnership that ensured the sustainability. Well, with that tool and with that idea in mind, we started developing the PBS pathway that I will describe. And in order to help countries assess and implement these tools, the national awareness And the commitment to notify was critically important, and we found that the countries that were much quicker in addressing the problems of H1 and H5N1 were the ones that were quickly and reporting, and primarily in the smaller backyard operations for people that lost their livelihoods when they reported because their birds, even when healthy, they were destroyed. And there was also a cultural collaboration. I think I will use Thailand as an example, where there was great collaboration by the large producers and the small producers. Not a single large producer was affected by avian influenza, thanks to their good biosecurity. And also, when it was not preventable, we had to look at the source and focus on where this thing comes from. And what we always said when I traveled with the Secretary of Health is that focus on the chickens. It's the chickens where we need to control the problem. And we also learned that the weakest infrastructure is the highest global risk. And for that, we believe that veterinary governance is a global public health. And we have to appreciate the help of the World Bank and many donors in helping us work together on this. So we're working on basically five platforms. One is the issue of the international standards, our obligations for disease prevention and control, and the quality of national veterinary services. The OIE path and the PVS pathway to assess and assist countries in implementing that. The WAHIS, not to forget that it's equally as important as the international standards, is our system, the World Health Information System, that I will describe briefly, where the information is disseminated immediately with follow-ups and allow members to see what is happening in the world and even adjust their trade practices accordingly. The reference laboratories, the OIE is a very small organization, but all our talent comes from about 300 reference laboratories and collaborating centers that your countries host and finance. And lastly, work that we're doing with my friend Margaret is in working together on how to deal with the implementation of these obligations on the OIE side and on IHR and see if we can learn from each other, particularly practicing this on countries who invite us to do this exercise. A brief history of the OIE is an intergovernmental organization that was founded in 1924 as a result of an outbreak of rinderpest introduced into Europe. It's composed of 180 members, 300 centers of international expertise. It is not a United Nations organization, and it is not. In 2003, the Director General, Dr. Valla, felt that we needed to modernize the system in many ways, and starting by the name, it's no longer the Office International des Epizooties, as it was originally named, something that mostly Francophone people understand what it is, but to us in English, it's not an office, it's not an oficina, so it was changed to World Organization for Animal Health. The mandate is basically transparency and sharing of information of animal health issues, collaborating and exchange on scientific information, and establishing the international standards for terrestrial and aquatic animals. Later on, in, thanks to the WTO-SPS agreement, they obtained kind of the legal teeth for these standards that had been developed since 1924. It has expanded to cover animal welfare and veterinary public health. Together with Codex Alimentarius, obviously, we address the part at the farm level in order to have a continuum from farm to fork. The important player here is the delegate. The delegate, quite often, is the chief veterinary officer of the country, is appointed by the country, and is the representative to the OIE. When making some comparison to the other organizations, some of the headaches Margaret may encounter, is fortunately, until today, is still a very technical organization, and we're not accompanied by many other wiser people. It's usually the chief vet and some of the technical experts that come to the OIE and make the decisions once a year at the General Assembly in May. And their role is to represent the national position with collaboration with private sector and public on the standard setting process, as well as to meeting the obligations on notification of disease according to the code. Since the activities of the delegate of the OIE are very, very wide and quite often wider than the responsibility of the chief veterinary officer in his country, the OIE established the so-called focal points. These are individuals appointed by the delegate in these areas of animal disease notification, wildlife, aquatic animal diseases, veterinary products, communication, animal welfare, production food safety, and veterinary laboratories. These individuals, once appointed, they're trained at regional level periodically to be able to allow the delegate to better represent these responsibilities and assist the OIE. and also serves as a technical contact point for us at the headquarters and at the regional level, and also to work on networks within the region. The standards are found in four different texts, the terrestrial and the aquatic code, which is broader recommendations such as surveillance, risk analysis and others, and disease-specific chapters, and then the manual for diagnostic and vaccines for the terrestrial and for the aquatic animals, as I call it, is the kitchen recipe where it gives indications of what are the updated diagnostic tools and the vaccines for a particular disease. So it's closely related and linked to the codes. The World Animal Health Information System, as I indicated, is equally as important. It's an excellent system where information has to be reported within 24 hours of the detection of either a listed disease or an emerging disease. This information is then updated weekly and eventually on twice a year. Additional information on the situation or the health situation of the country, plus information related to vaccine production, national laboratory capacity, some of the broader aspects of the operation of the veterinary services. All of this is online. Now, the PVS pathway is a continuous process aiming at improving the compliance of the veterinary services with these standards and a sustainable efficiency. It has been recognized as a system of measurements and evaluations that is an effective foundation for improving animal health and public health at a national, regional, and international level. It's a bit like a patient, and we started with a PVS evaluation, and it was great. The only problem is, as you know, once you go to a doctor, you still don't get any better until you receive the prescription and the treatment. And so these were follow-ups. These developed later after we started applying the PVS evaluation. So the evaluation is the one that I copied from Kevin Walker and Ika. It's a qualitative assessment of the veterinary services performance on the basis of 47 criteria, all included in the terrestrial code, international standard that have been adopted by the members, dealing with the quality of veterinary services. And it helps raise the awareness and improve the understanding of all sectors, including other administrations, and about the fundamental components and critical competence that these services have to have. So these 47 competencies have been divided into four columns, one dealing with human, physical, and financial resources, one with technical capacity and authority, laboratories and others, one with the interaction with interested parties, private-public partnership, how they relate to other ministries, and market access. And each of these competencies then is judged at five levels of advancement. I may say that these evaluations are conducted at the invitation of the member country and conducted by expert trained by the OIE and approved by these countries. The result of these evaluations is confidential, and it's up to the country to make it public, and we'll mention a little bit about that. Then comes the prescription. The prescription comes at the time that the member country has had the opportunity to study the evaluation, to line it up with its priorities, and to call the OIE again to come back for this step. This step, rather than being an evaluation by the experts on evidence found in the country, is more driven by the country with the assistance of the experts, where these competencies are realigned in a different set of columns based on the outcomes desired by this country. So in this case, we line them up under trade, animal health, veterinary public health, veterinary laboratories, and management and regulatory services. And then there's a complex spreadsheet where once we have tabulated the cost of construction, salaries, average price of fuels, et cetera, that at the end there's a balance sheet with the cost. So we determine and confirm first the country's priorities, define the expected results for each of these priorities within a period of 5 years. We determine the activities required to reach the desired levels, and then the corresponding human, physical, and financial resources on the basis of this table. And then they have an annual budget for the next 5 years. We have found that in numerous countries, veterinary legislation is outdated and inadequate. And any member that has taken this PVS evaluation may request a mission dedicated specifically to address the issue of legislation. And the OIE has a chapter specifically dedicated to the essential elements in veterinary legislation. There's also follow-up missions. So once we have completed this, countries can request every 3 to 5 years missions just to help monitor the progress and to see whether changes need to be done. So where do we are now? Out of the 180 member countries, 133 have requested an evaluation. This is just the evaluation part. 123 have been completed. 69 are available to restricted, particularly to donors, and 20 are already on the public website. The distribution of these, you will see heavy emphasis on Africa, Asia, and active participation by South America. A very interesting note, only a few weeks old. You may imagine all of the developing countries have already participated. We have received a request of Australia to go through the entire process, scheduled to begin in late August, in late October and finish by mid-November. And I have a pleasure to say that I've been selected to be one of the members. It has been expanded to 4 rather than 3 experts into 3.5 weeks rather than 2. The blue indicate countries that have requested a specific approach. China, where the OIE went and trained 100 experts in China to become more familiar with the tool before they determine how they will do at a national level. The European Union, who has already a great number of experts on the European Union that will do this internally. I don't think it's very helpful if PBS shows that one is better than another of the members. In Canada, who is in discussions already to, I believe, maybe the next one to request a full-blown PBS evaluation. On the gap analysis, the costing tool, 96 countries have requested it, 80 have already been completed, and 13 are available on the web. In the distribution, as you can imagine, the heavy emphasis has been in Africa, and Africa has progressed greater than the others on this gap analysis. What's the overall diagnosis? After looking at these 130 evaluations, in general, we can see that there's commonly inadequate chain of command, the regions, the locals, to the headquarters, certainly inadequate budget, and what concerns me, mainly because of lack of crisis in the animal world, I see the budget of veterinary services shrinking, both in developed and developing countries. Unsuitable veterinary legislation, very common. Aging veterinary population, you're looking at it. Absence, a lack of control over veterinary paraprofessionals, very commonly used in Africa, but we don't realize in developed countries is equally as important. These are laboratory technicians, field people that are involved in early detection and reporting in the field level where quite often veterinarians are not present. Very weak emergency preparedness and response. Surveillance and laboratory network is underperforming, and we have developed a system of twinning where it established reference laboratories, thanks to the funding of our trust fund, develop a training project to raise the level of diagnostic laboratories in countries that don't have them, in regions that don't have them. Very weak control of veterinary products. We're talking about antimicrobial resistance, and the distribution of veterinary products in many countries is completely out of control. And need to collaborate with other relevant stakeholders. And I think this is one thing that as a small organization, I think it's been easier, that we cannot do our job without collaborating with the private sector as well as with other intergovernmental organizations. So at the request of members, and I had the opportunity doing a PBS evaluation in Costa Rica, and then the same thing happened in Kenya and in Thailand, they said, we work very closely with the public health sector. Why can we not do it together? And that led to a conversation between WHO and OIE, and with the support of the World Bank, there's an approach now investigating a more harmonious approach to the national capacities, whether we do the diagnosis together or separate, but I think the gap analysis part, the how do you move here from here forward for the next 3 years, will give us a great opportunity to be able to do this together, and not only public health and animal health, but some of the other sectors as well, and use the experience and the willingness of the countries that have already participated in our project. So in conclusion, I think global health is not just about response, it is not just about human health. We need to invest more and more in prevention, although unfortunately, today is the day of indicators. It's very difficult to find a good indicator for prevention because you will never know what you prevented. And investigate past failures. We need to focus more, and I think we are learning that, and we will be discussing it today. Need to help comply with the obligations and reward transparency. Countries that don't have the ability to respond to the OIE obligations to IHR need to be helped because it's our own risk to leave these countries in a weak position. The assessment of readiness, in our opinion, has to be external. We cannot ask countries to self-evaluate themselves. The leadership and the political must be born locally. We have to encourage the formation of leaders at the local level. Intergovernmental organizations must be modernized and give a better example, but I do give a word of caution. I've been the president of the standard-setting body of the OIE for 15 years, and I've witnessed how the Codex Alimentarius and the OIE have developed standards completely contradicting themselves, going in opposite directions. And why? Because the delegate of your country, my country, going to Codex has certain ideas, and the delegate going to the OIE has other ideas. They don't talk to each other, and they give mandate to these organizations that contradict themselves, and Codex can only do what its members tell them to do, and the OIE does the same. So I think the collaboration has to start at home, and we have to develop a common policy of what we want these intergovernmental organizations to do before we criticize them. So in conclusion, I think veterinary governance is a global public good that will benefit the international community at negligible cost. I may tell you here, Dr. Valla is not present, that it's been less than $10 million that has been invented in this entire exercise of evaluations, of gap analysis, of twinning, of focal point training, thanks to the donation of donors to the OIE Trust Fund. Compliance with the obligation of transparency must be rewarded and must be made public. So good governance for us is to comply with international standards, to have a suitable veterinary legislation and the resources to execute it. Surveillance and early detection, reporting, and rapid response are crucial. We to continue to promote partnerships. More and more, we find the great collaboration of the private sector and the producing sector. In a country, people that are involved in industrial production, they are at the biggest risk. The governments, unfortunately, are becoming weaker and weaker, but if they don't participate, they're going to be much more vulnerable when the veterinary service is not able to prevent or to certify. Provide initial and continuing veterinary education. Initially, we were not very well understood, but the academic community has really welcomed the work, and now we have a joint working group establishing the what we call day one competencies, not what a veterinary curriculum should be, but what are the elements that every veterinarian in the world should have. Today, we have veterinary schools that graduate individuals after 2 years. We have to level the playing field and elevate it. We have to utilize these PVS tools, and we will shortly complete and will publish the guidelines on disaster management. This is something was initially challenged by the members to say something about natural disasters. Quickly, we realized that it really doesn't matter if it's natural or not natural, and the guidelines identify and describe very clearly all of the agencies and expertise that need to be involved in a disaster, whether it's health or otherwise. So meeting the OIE standards on quality veterinary services is critical to protecting animal health and public health, achieving food safety and food security outcomes, and benefiting from the economic opportunities of international trade. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much with this wonderful presentation. Now we are going to open the floor for discussion. Dr. Feinberg.
I'd like to pose a question to each of our speakers, if I may. Dr. Fiedler, when you speak of the governance in terms of the application of power, does that not imply, relating back to Professor Takami's presentation, agreement in the first instance among sovereign nations to either share or delegate or arrange the assignment of power under these circumstances? And if I may, Alejandro, to you to ask a question. For governance, you alluded to the fact that OIE is not a part of the UN system. My question to you in the application and operation of the programs, is that a plus, a minus, or indifferent to your ability to carry out your work?
In terms of the idea of governance or the exercise of political power, this is going to be the lawyer's answer. It depends. It depends who has political power and for what they want to exercise it for. So in some circumstances, it is states having to reach agreement in order either to delegate or fund authority. But we know in the context of the proliferation of global health governance that we have actors who have political power who are not states. So non-state actors, foundations can often drive agendas. And so in terms of when we think about political power in the contemporary scene of global health governance, we do have to think about states, but that's not sufficient in terms of what we've seen empirically in terms of the development of, or insertion of non-state actor political power into these governance processes.
Dr. Feinberg, I think we are Chatham House rules too late. Right? It's certainly a plus that we're not United Nations in the sense that it's a very small, flexible organization. We had to adjust to our limitations. The budget of the OIE is extremely limited. The six categories, the highest contributors, $140,000 to $150,000 a year. And the developing countries is one-hundredth of that. But because of the creation of these tools and the very rapid response from the donors in many countries, today we have a trust fund that is three times a year what the budget of the OIE is. So we have expanded into capacity building, which was not a mission or an obligation of the OIE, as was just to collect information and disseminate. But I think the timing was just right, and we capitalized on the fact that when H5N1 hit started with Asia, the World Bank had learned about our tool, and they said, we don't want to intervene in a country unless we have seen the diagnosis, where the weak and the strong points, rather than where the consultant is going to lead us. So one thing led to the other, but it's extremely flexible. By not being United Nations, we certainly collaborate and work very closely with them, but we have the Director General and the board has much more flexibility in operating. And the other thing is, I hope it remains like this. I was a representative of the U.S. for Codex Alimentarius, and Codex has changed with time. The delegate at the OIE is sitting by himself or herself with some technical advisors. There is no State Department. There is no private sector industry sitting at the side. So the decisions are very technical in nature, and the impact on trade is viewed later. I fear that with time, this will change. But it's a very, very technical, very rapid making decision. We can develop a new standard with circulation members twice a year in a rapid time of 2 years. Codex Alimentarius takes a minimum of 8 years. So standards are adjusted and modified according to new evidence, to new science, and to input from the members.
Okay, Peter Datsak.
Yeah, hi.
It is working.
It is
okay. Very good. Question for David Fidler. The governance issue is one side of this, but what about the financial issues? So if there's a big push for a private sector funding for a sort of global pandemic fund, and it doesn't go along the same lines as the logical governance structure that anybody proposes, how can that be dealt with? Does that scupper the good governance aspect? And if so, how can that be sort of headed off before we get there?
Well, certainly financing is a key part of the exercise of political power. And often you want to follow the money, right? What are states or non-state actors investing in for purposes of global health? And the questions related to good governance really come at two levels. The first one, which is often the debate, is
in terms of that particular source of funding, is that going to lead to the kinds of good governance that we want, particularly, for example, accountability? The second level of good governance in terms of financing is within the governance instrument or the process or the target that you've set with that funding, right? So is the money being spent transparently? And does the institution or the state providing the bulk of the funding, is it on board with transparency? And we see this with development assistance. We see this as one of the concerns coming out of Ebola. There's a lot of money that was given, but nobody knows how exactly it was all spent, right? So there's those two-level problems. One, we had to rely in this context on ad hoc donations coming in to deal with this that's that top-level problem, right? Mm-hmm. And there the exercise of political power is coming from the major donors, right? Sounds familiar, right? Second issue, okay, if we have that governance project underway, does that reflecting these criteria of good governance? And we have a problem there, right, in connection with that. So it operates at both of those levels.
Jeffrey Dutchin.
Thank you both. Is the mic on?
Yeah.
Thank you both for those presentations. They're outstanding. I have a question for Mr. Fidler, also following up on the comments about governance. And you made a pretty strong case from my perspective about the application of political power sort of being out of sync with at least the current principles of global health governments or good governance. And I'm wondering, I want to explore a little bit more with you how that could be reconciled. For example, you gave some illustrations of situations where things didn't work well, where the exercise of political power wasn't aligned with what was desired in terms of global health governance. And I'm wondering if there are other examples or precedents that you think can inform our discussions about the design of a more effective governance structure, and in particular, how do we incorporate this issue of what seems to me somewhat unpredictable, but maybe there are ways to sort of predict application of political power and political interests in a global health governance structure. Is that even possible, or should we be developing should we be thinking about a system that would function in the absence of the ability to manage political interests and power?
I'm gonna handle that one last. All right, I'll give you two examples of where I think people believe that the political interests and the willingness to exercise political power reached alignment and moved global health governance forward. The first one you might think odd because it falls apart in Ebola, but that's the international health regulations. I think, and David Heyman I don't want to go into too much detail because I think David Heyman is going to describe that, but that really was a moment where you had states, non-state actors, WHO on the same page to create a radically new approach to the problem of epidemic infectious diseases as well as other emergency contexts. As I tried to describe, you hit all of those categories of what we try to think about in terms of good governance, right, with this proliferation tying it in with this strategy. So it was strategic, it had these ideas of good governance in it. It was trying to do that to make sure that there was real political support, formation of political interests, and at least resource commitments at country level for purposes of moving this forward. Well, that didn't last, right? That political support really did not, and we've seen this, right? And again, I don't want to get into the IHR too much, but this is the problem with the exercise of political power, is it becomes fluid and things can change dramatically. Now, outside the second thing I want to do, which is interesting to me, because when I've been involved in debates about post-Ebola and people are looking for alternative governance models that they think work as opposed to the IHR, many of those models, if not all of those models, are models that work outside or are independent of WHO. That's very interesting, right? And so again, I think that's a really big question. So if the formation of political interests and the willingness to exercise political power wants to be semi-autonomous or independent of WHO, public-private partnerships, global fund, rollback malaria, polio, these are the things people point to as being effective, right? So they say, we should do the same thing in connection with Ebola. Well, do those political interests and the exercise of political power with those models match up with what we see coming out of Ebola? Right. That's what I'm encouraging the commission and the workforce stream to do. Look at that seriously. Because when you start to probe some of these things in terms of that, it's not that these are impossible ideas, right? But it becomes a different task to make sure that you're aligning these things in a way which is going to create good governance, right? And so that would be. Oh, and then in terms, should we be thinking about a system that doesn't align to the exercise of political power? Hmm. Good luck. I don't think you can. I mean, this is if we really want to boil it down as starkly as possible, governance is about the exercise of political power. That's money. It's political capital. It's influence. It's capabilities. It's personnel. Right? In other contexts, this is known as the blood and treasure test. Unless you're willing to put blood and treasure on the line, it's not politically important to you, right? I mean, that doesn't necessarily work in this context, but there's a similar sort of reality check that's needed here. Even the statement that we could think about a system that isn't aligned with political interests is a political statement, right?
So can I follow up on that? So I wasn't suggesting that we ignore the reality, but should we plan for the fact that political interests and power may not align in the moment? For example, the IHR, which you propose as a, you know, relatively good process and structure, has not been as effective as it should be. And so what I'm wondering is, should we, you know, take that into consideration and not assume that political interests and power will align when the event occurs?
No, you can't. Because in order to make progress coming out of an event like Ebola, you have to look at the political tea leaves. I don't know how you do it otherwise, right? We can create something that's not connected with us and hope maybe the political interests, then we're just getting lucky, right? As opposed to sort of thinking through the way in which, and that's what I think was so clever and profound about what was done with the IHR. Now, did we drop the ball coming out of that change and not continuing to focus on that at a political level? And a lot of what I hear, particularly from country level, is that the IHR became this irritating checklist that did not align with national priorities on health. And so they began to exercise political power in ways that did not reflect the importance of the IHR. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how much political attention was being paid to that political problem.
Okay, we do have a temporal problem because there are so many people interested to discuss, because the discussion, it's real going deep in the thing that we are trying to clarify in this part of the session. So I'm going to skip to give just two additional words of all the people that have asked the floor, Dr. Peter Piot, and Margaret Chan. And then I'm going to ask the rest to keep the questions for the second part of the discussion after the coffee. We're going to have the review of the lesson learned. I have all the writing the people who request the floor in order to advance in the discussion. So Peter Piot and Dr. Margaret Chan, and then we're moving to the coffee break and begin the second part and continue the discussion.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the three inspiring talks. Certainly, first of all, I'd like to agree that this is about political power and also about communities, I mean, and how to bring that together. And so it is an illusion, I think, to just go for technical approaches. I think that's, we shouldn't even discuss that, I think, at this workshop. And that's why we should pay at least as much attention to states and governments as to the global institutions and architecture. I feel that the debate is out of sync with the reality of how the world functions, and that all attention is on the easy target, you know, and not on what the ecosystem that we have. And let's not forget that power relations can evolve, and they are evolving in the world, and that's not taken into account. So my second point is that there must be a reason for this proliferation and for this pluralism. It's not that this was a conspiracy or what. It's part of the 21st century, particularly. We are moving more and more into, to abuse that word again, to ecosystems and networks that were the resultant of it defines what is going to happen. And that is fine for many aspects of global health or for health. With WHO as a knowledge hub and et cetera and its other functions, and when there is no acute crisis. But as David also said, for emergencies, it's a disaster. It doesn't work, because that's where you need command and control, and you cannot spend your time in trying to build consensus. And I think that's our problem. So rather than to try to fix the whole system, I hope we can concentrate on the question of the day. And I think this is where consolidation is probably needed, and certainly at the governance level, where something like the World Health Assembly is totally inappropriate or not adapted for this kind of issues. This is more of a domain of like a UN Security Council when we stay in the UN system type, although there is clearly also a democratic deficit. It is needed for, there is a need to get out of the, systems like for governance, like the World Health Assembly, where it's extremely difficult to get anything done. And then finally also that there needs to be among the member states, the political powers, an agreement needs to be brokered to whom to delegate in case of a crisis, because in case of a crisis, you delegate power for the time of the crisis, and then you evaluate, and you can agree or not agree. And I think that's part of the political questions that we have. And so a question also to our panel is that, do we really have to fix the whole system? Because that may never go, and then by the time we fixed it, it's probably obsolete. Or can we just zoom in on what our problem is? Thank you.
Dr. Chang?
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the two presentations and respond to some of the points that were raised by David Fidler. And I fully agree with you that the 2005 IHR review was a very good political moment. And countries spent time to negotiate a good instrument to move from a reactive to a proactive approach and to pay attention to early detection and prevention. But what went wrong? Because countries dropped the ball. And the compliance, to start with, only 66 countries, one-third of all countries in WHO have really complied with what they promised at the negotiation. Now, the second point, David, you talk about why things like partnership work outside of WHO. It is important to listen to the voices of the less rich countries and the countries who are less powerful. Those partnerships are seen in many countries as ways to bypass the legitimacy of countries who don't have the means to drive the agenda. One of the points you make is the donors drive the agenda. We need also to listen to the countries who are not around at this table. The last point is 21st century world, WHO, including many UN agencies, we really need to change, because the world is very different. No government in this world can provide the services and provide all the support without the non-state actors' engagement. And of course, the definition of non-state actors, for me, in WHO, we include societies, civil society, academic, and of course, industry, and the list is quite long. The fact that in WHO, countries of the world couldn't even agree to include non-state actor as part of the debate and discussion. And this is the biggest hurdle we need to overcome. Why are countries so possessive? Can't even open up and let people to let their voices heard and let them make the contribution. And this is the crux of the matter. Thank you.
So, David, the last word before coffee, but not the last word.
Well,
your reaction to
all right. quickly, in terms of the question about do we have to fix the entire system, the answer, of course, is no. But even if we try to pick the system that is most of concern coming out of Ebola, this system is enormously complex, has many different, I mean, so to fix this system is going to require knock-on effects with regards to much of the proliferation. It's difficult to disentangle some of that. And you'll see that in debates about consolidation, right? Oh, we're going to cut back. Oh, well, what about the impact here? What about, I mean, it gets extremely complicated. So, no, we're not trying to fix the entire system, but you will affect the entire system, but the governance choices that are made in connection with these issues. And yes, Director General Chan, you make a lot of points that are live and controversial in connection with the political debates about what do we do going forward. So the legitimacy of WHO is a place where less powerful countries can come and have a voice. Obviously is not shared by those governments that want to go outside WHO in order to get something done. So you have disagreement about whether or not that institution, that piece of global health governance, actually connects to the good governance notion of legitimacy. Right? That's a really difficult context. And I think, again, that's where this commit, we're all struggling with that, right? How do you triangulate this problem such that we can bring political interests sufficiently into alignment so that we can sustain it for longer than the IHR were sustained. I mean, if that doesn't give you a pit in your stomach, it ought to, right? I mean, this is very difficult, things that we're talking about if we focus on governance as the exercise of political power.
Okay.
Just very quickly, I think we need to prevent trying to find a solution to today's problem as we did with H5N1. Every time there's an outbreak, we try to find the fix so that next time avian influenza comes, it doesn't happen, and the next time it was not in chickens and it was not avian influenza. I think we need to concentrate on peacetime in assisting those countries that have the will and not the means. And so are the powers, political or otherwise, willing to invest during peacetime in those that are the weakest, because the day tomorrow we are going to be very vulnerable because of that. And I think the OIS, a small organization with the trust fund, has to compete against FAO and some of the others in getting money, and I think we have accomplished that through accountability. And I invite you to look at the reports at the end of the year or how the money was spent and the response from countries. And we need to look at those indicators. Has the investment in peacetime done well, or do we need to modify it so that we are better prepared when the next crisis comes?
Okay, let's go for the coffee break, Maria.
And let's return at 5 minutes before the hour.
Okay.
Thank you.
Very good. So you're more for consolidation? Or